Ray who? Rey Skywalker.
What weird alternate dimension am I in?
You know what you did.
The Rise of Skywalker is a complete, total, and unmitigated disaster.
What a biblical fuck-up.
Say, how long do you think it'll be until critics learn how to judge a film by anything other than its title?
You're lying!
Then again, we're living in a world where every major franchise in existence is being milked all of its worth, so maybe I should take this stupidity as more of a cry for help.
Sexist?
I mean, you could probably imagine Bob Iger strangling this one with a belt, so maybe I'm not too far off. But getting back on track, what happened to Star Wars? Once a mighty champion of a franchise that revolutionized filmmaking as a whole and inspired millions of people worldwide, now a corporate money-making cow with zero artistic integrity that was somehow run into the ground after only 3 years and is now suffering from utter dysfunction. I had to Google that, by the way. Disney really went out of their way to turn one of the most popular and beloved franchises of all time into just another generic series of sci-fi flicks. It's almost like the most wealthy corporation on the planet is only interested in your wallet. I mean, I can certainly respect it from a business perspective. Buy the most popular franchise of all time, put two of the biggest hacks in Hollywood and that guy who directed an overrated time travel movie in charge, and just watch the money roll in from people who only wish to be given the magic they experienced as a kid from that galaxy far, far away. But I'm not interested in business. I dodged that bullet by a long mile. I'm instead particularly interested in how Jar Jar Bankrooms and
Fuck off, Hector Waterford Catley!
Kennedy managed to destroy any hope of Star Wars being taken seriously as a film franchise ever again, in just one fatal move. Why was the fall of Rey Fakewalker the fatal move and not The Last Jedi? Well, allow me to explain. Even though Ruin Long Johnson's handling of Star Wars can be summed up by an out-of-context Gravity Falls clip,
whatever it is, I'll understand. There is nothing about this I understand.
There was still a lot of potential for Disney to actually do something with the IP. And even though Ryan's movie got a lot of backlash, I mean, did you watch The Last Jedi? The franchise was still somewhat stable despite a bitterly and justifiably divided fanbase.
Oh my god!
There was plenty of potential for Disney to milk the franchise the correct way by actually producing things that people wanted to see. Fast forward 5 months and then we got Solo. No one saw that one, and good for them.
Assume everyone will betray you and you will never be disappointed.
Yeah, fuck off. And even though Clone Wars was announced to be coming back, it would still be from an ending that was planned before Disney made the decision to cancel it. So I'm not seeing much raw talent here. In truth, there is not a single good Disney Star Wars movie, with only one of them actually showing some sort of competency being placed into it, due to some parts of the director's original movie remaining, after Disney mashed multiple takes on the film into one messy pile of fan service. People only liked The Force Awakens because it deployed Jujar's sacred mystery box tactic and created a bunch of loose ends that you never had any intention of following up properly. Because once you take away the mystery, you'll end up saying that The Force Awakens is a messy, convoluted car crash that makes absolutely no sense both in the universe it takes place in and as a standalone film. But because people liked it marginally more compared to The Last Jedi, people were clamoring for Bankrooms to come back to end the trilogy he began so haphazardly with some misplaced but understandable hope the final movie in the 9-part Skywalker saga would at the very least be a decent send-off. Unfortunately, they couldn't be further from the reality of the situation. Money Wars, The Rise of Kennedy is one of the worst pieces of cinematic wreckage I've ever seen in my entire life. At least with Ryan's movie, you could tell there was some sort of soul behind it with meaningful and emotionally resonant themes. Too bad they were handled about as well as a chimp with Alzheimer's being put in charge of a roller coaster. But The Fall of Jubar isn't just soulless. It's a corporate product disguised as a meaningful ending to a beloved saga that manages to kill every single part of its entire franchise. Remember how The Force Awakens destroyed the ending for the OT? And then The Last Jedi destroyed The Force Awakens and OT? Well, The Rise of Skywalker not only tries to undo every horrible story choice that The Last Jedi made by somehow doing an even worse job than Ryan ever could, it also destroys Jar Jar's own fucking movie, as well as the OT and the prequels. But why stop there when you have every other part of the franchise to nuke into oblivion? The story choices in Skywalker The Off-Rise have knock-on effects that manage to harm Star Wars media outside of the goddamn movies. Not even the Clone Wars was safe from the night of the long retcon. And believe me, I was not prepared to handle the amount of basic writing techniques that were handled about as well as a limp cactus. And while the story and writing will make up a large chunk of what I have to say, I will try my best to cover other aspects of the film during my analysis. Lots of issues brought up, maybe things you're already aware of already, but hey, shitting on the movie is more fun than trying to compare it to other videos that have been done already. Oh, and before you say I'm half a year late to this, I'd like to remind you that The Force Awakens was a 32-year late continuation of a franchise that already had its well-earned conclusion, so I think you can spare me a little mercy on that one. So without further ado, this is The Rise of Skywalker. So this is the story of how the film's writers created the Rise of Skywalker story. Want to hear it? Me neither, but I'm doing it anyway. Lucasfilm sees the absolute mess they've created and need a bit of help. So they contact the man who they originally hired to start this trilogy off. Enter Jujar Bankrums. He ruined Star Trek, but other notable incidents that sadly happened in his career, including directing The Force Awakens. Now this movie was quite possibly one of the most highly anticipated of all time. It had been a while since the last Star Wars movie, and people were still bitter over the prequels, excluding Revenge of the Sith, being as bad as they were. In reality, they had no knowledge of how well they had been treated. It was said to be the start of a new trilogy, one that would captivate new audiences the way that the original trilogy did all those years ago. Breathtaking visuals, the old cast members returning, and the reputation of the previous movies behind it. It was going to be the greatest movie of all time. Then it released.
It's one fine looking barbecue pit. Why doesn't mine look like that?
Jujar had just taken the first movie and painted over it, with only a few small tweaks to the story. I mean, after all, that's what he's always done. But to say people weren't happy about the return of their favourite franchise being the same movie they saw upwards of 40 years ago would have been an understatement. And despite having the blueprint of a story that was actually good in his hands, Banks still managed to cock it up spectacularly by introducing a number of contrived plot points, holes both in the story and literally, and killing off a beloved character in a scene that manages to make me laugh without fail every time. But for some reason, people seemed to like it for the first month of release. Hell, it was more than just liked. Some people were saying it was one of the best movies in the entire saga. People loved this movie. But then after a month, everyone realized they'd just been subjected to a movie that hits the audience over the head with car keys and loose ends to generate a sustaining audience for an entire trilogy. Now, if you came up to me and told me that The Force Awakens was a good movie, well, first of all... But second of all, I would have agreed that there are plenty of ways for a sequel to go, given all the questions TFA set up to be answered. You could have explored any of what Rey saw in that vision of hers, tell us who the fuck Snoke is, or at the very least tell us how Orange Lady got Luke's lightsaber.
Where'd you get that?
A good question. For another time.
Bitch!
There are plenty of ways to salvage a good movie out of the wreckage. Then we got The Last Jedi. So for the final movie in the sequel trilogy to succeed, they had to try and tie up as many loose ends as they possibly could, whilst providing fans with a satisfying conclusion to a 9-part saga that people have been invested in for decades. How well could it have possibly gone? Well, without using the obligatory use of reaction clips, like for example... I can probably point to a few key reasons as to why it went so poorly. Bankrums is not a very good writer. He certainly found his place in producing movies, but I would never want him behind a camera or computer for anything. And what of the other writer for this movie? Oh yes, there was another writer for The Rise of Skywalker, because not even Jujar could come up with such an autistic script on his own. Enter Kiss Terrias. You might have no idea who this person is, and I say that makes you a complete faggot. How could you not know who Kiss Terrias is, you fucking nerd? I mean, just look at his incredible track record.
Holy fish paste, what is that?
Hey Kathleen, I've got an idea. How about you fucking hire the guy who fucking wrote Batman vs. fucking Superman, and then you can finally kill Star Wars, you decrepit cunt.
Okay, not seeing much to work with here, but I'm sure they'll pull through.
All these things we had to balance, and it was really about just, you know, asking ourselves what delights us and what do we feel this movie should be.
Rise Skywalker.
The birth of our child. So JJ's so excited, I'm so excited, Kathy and Michelle are so excited.
The Rise of Skywalker was practically doomed from the start. It had an absolutely impossible task of concluding not just the sequel trilogy but the entire Skywalker saga, while also attempting to rectify Ryan's mistakes to please fans who hate The Last Jedi, while also trying to keep the fans of The Last Jedi happy, while also trying to give depth and background to the characters who we don't even know yet at the end of their own fucking trilogy, tie up the loose ends and mysteries that Eubanks foolishly set up having no idea where they can go, while also trying to actually define Rey as a character, while also attempting to completely contradict the themes, ideas, and philosophy that the trilogy was given from The Last Jedi, in an attempt to fix that movie's mistakes, to make this trilogy even more messy and directionless than it already fucking was, while also jingling car keys painted with nostalgia bait to trick the audience into thinking they're watching something that they enjoy, because the movie lacks any kind of emotional substance, which also ties into bringing back a villain who had already been used twice, who had never been brought up at any point in the trilogy, and who died by exploding two times 30 fucking years ago. So let's see how that actually played out in the film. So this is the story for The Rise of Skywalker. Want me to go over why it's terrible? Probably. Me too. Let's go. The title crawl begins and we get our first line. The dead speak. Someone was paid to write that, by the way. We are then told that a mysterious message has been sent out to the galaxy by Emperor fucking Palpatine. Okay. So imagine you went into The Rise of Skywalker after watching the previous two films without viewing any of the marketing material for it. Specifically, if you were a casual moviegoer who finds out the film is a thing only a month before release, with an alternate poster where Palpatine is removed. If you went into this movie like that, which I can assume is quite a few people, you would be left utterly confused at Palpatine being alive, and for good reason, is how he was vaporized and blown up only 30 years ago. So you can gather that viewing the movie like that will leave you confused, right? So what about the people who did know Palpatine was going to be in the film, which is the majority? Well, it still doesn't get much better! Because the way the movie handles Palpatine's return is nothing short of cognitively retarded. An outright going, oh, he's back, lol, in the first paragraph of the opening crawl isn't going to do you any favors. And it seems as if there's a piece of the film missing. What is this mysterious message that old Palpy sent out to people to give them the spooks? Isn't that supposed to be the reason why everyone is suddenly panicking and putting the plot into action? I guess we'll just never know. Unless you played Fortnite Battle Royale during its Star Wars themed event at a very specific time, where you were then subjected to hearing Palpatine's message to the entire fucking galaxy.
The great error is corrected. The day of victory is at hand. The day of revenge. The day of the Sith.
A pivotal part of the story for the last movie in a 40-year-long saga is hidden away in a random game just to give the writers more room to rush the story. Lucasfilm Storytelling 2019. If you forget something when scripting, just put it in Fortnite. Cinema at its finest. God. We then learn that apparently Rey is training to become a true Jedi now. Rey's training? Badass. You saw what she did in the last movie, now that's weak sauce. She might have beaten Luke Skywalker in a duel after only using the Force and the lightsaber a few days prior and had become a complete god of the Force by performing stunts that not even Yoda could do, but now she still needs more power, fuck it, this is totally fixing her being a Mary Sue. Oh yeah, and Kylo is still out there being the angriest human being to ever human. Why is he raging in search of the Emperor? He can't be so angry that he's literally shitting himself with over the galaxy in search for him, right? You might think I'm nitpicking that line, and you are absolutely right. Given that rage is the only thing I associate with Kylo Ren other than Hot Topic, I'd say that this was a line that can be left up for interpretation. Personally, I think it would be a lot funnier if Kylo was angrily screaming to death metal while flying in his TIE fighter, so I'm treating that as canon. Okay, so we're not even 3 minutes into the film and already a multitude of things are wrong. Palpatine was never set up or even talked about, let alone referenced in any of the movies in the sequel trilogy, and now suddenly he's back and has been pulling the strings of the First Order this entire time. But we'll get into that in a second. We cut to Kylo Ren completely fucking up a mysterious red and white planet. Now you might be wondering what this planet is called, as it appears to be the only planet in the movie that isn't actually named. While it isn't important, it was actually revealed to be Mustafar a few days after the movie was released. Mustafar, you say? Strange. I don't seem to recall Mustafar looking this aesthetically pleasing or having trees. I mean, that place was basically
Krakatoa!
But I guess it's like this now, so that's cool, I guess. Would have been cool if we actually had some sort of explanation for that, if you really felt it was necessary for people to know that it was Mustafar, but I guess we'll never know. Unless you pay hundreds of dollars for a VR headset, then pay an extra 30 for a VR game called Vader Immortal, where you find out that Vader tries to use the Bright Star to resurrect Padme, but some guy destroyed it, causing Mustafar to magically heal back to how it was hundreds of years ago. A part of the story for the last movie in a 40-year-long saga is hidden away in an expensive VR game, just so the writers can take the fact that they included the planet people might recognize. Lucasfilm Storytelling 2019. If you don't want to explain anything, charge people hundreds of dollars for the answer. Cinema at its peak. Anyway, back onto Kylo Ren. He just fucking moonwalked in medieval combat and it worked. Another thing you'll notice with this movie is that it has some of the worst choreographed combat of any movie in the saga, and that is against some stiff-ass competition. The fact that the main duel between Rey and Kylo Ren looks less engaging and impactful than a duel between two senile old men holding their weapons like children holding bottles of vodka.
I'll try spinning, that's a good trick.
Kso. Really says a lot about the effort put into having good fight choreography in a series where the emotional weight of the film's climax in a final duel. Oh yeah, there was a choreographer for this movie. It's easy to forget that sometimes. Kylo is actually searching for a Sith wayfinder that apparently belonged to Darth Vader, hence why he's now on Mustafar. It may not look like it at first, but this wayfinder starts the movie's decline into not being taken seriously whatsoever by the half an hour mark. The Rise of Skywalker is a movie that relies on MacGuffins to progress the story. It would be okay if these were just things they collected, but no. It's a story about a MacGuffin that can locate another MacGuffin that leads straight to the hideout of Emperor Palpatine. But since Kylo has a wayfinder and not that fucking piece of shit knife, fucking shove the fucking knife up your fucking arse, is able to locate Palpatine's planet named Exegol. This is apparently a super secret Sith planet that's never been discovered by anyone before, and that is because to find it you have to go through this cloud of red gas and space debris that for some reason you have to go through, despite there being endless amounts of space around its entrance and exit. So really, anyone can find Exegol from any direction and don't have to go through that red mist. So why did Kylo need the wayfinder when he can just take one look at the dangerous death route, practically say fuck it and just go around it? Especially given the fact that you know where the planet is because you have the wayfinder. Just move around the massive fucking Ebola strain, you malignant shit funnel. Kylo makes it to Exegol and finds Emperor Palpatine alive and well. Although it's never explicitly stated in the film if he's the original Palpatine or just the clone, because Jubanks and Terrias are the suicidal writing equivalent of Beavis and Butthead. This is because the entire movie feels like it has no script to follow. It just farts along with zero intelligence or thought being put into what's happening on screen. We all know anyway that Palpatine was only brought back as a desperate attempt to win back old fans after Ryan pissed in everyone's coffee, but in bringing back Palpatine, they have already completely insulted the fans of the original trilogy once more by rendering Anakin's sacrifice completely pointless. Anakin was always supposed to fulfill the prophecy and bring balance to the Force once and for all, and he did just that in Return of the Jedi. But no, Palpatine is alive, Anakin died for nothing, what a fucking idiot.
Oh, Anakin, no! No!
And my, is the dialogue here confusing. Palpatine makes numerous statements hinting that he is the original Palpatine, even directly quoting himself with a line from the prequels.
The dark side of the Force is a pathway to many abilities some consider to be unnatural.
But later in the film, we have hints that he could possibly be a clone. I guess we'll just never know the answer. Unless you buy the Rise of Skywalker novelization that explains once and for all that Palpatine is actually a clone. No idea why he for some reason had a clone of himself created during Return of the Jedi, as this still doesn't make an atom of goddamn sense, but he's a clone now. A pivotal part of the story for the last movie in the 40-year-long saga is hidden away in a book version of the film you paid money for, just so the writers can distract you from thinking with pretty lights and a nostalgia bait villain. Lucasfilm Storytelling 2019. If you don't want to explain anything, write a fucking book. Cinema at its gold is standard. Sheesh. When I'm pretty sure some of you are aware that the Empire wasn't entirely defeated after the Return of the Jedi, and there were still a few battles that took place. And assuming that this wasn't cut from canon, that basically means that Palpatine had let his Empire fall without giving a shit. But don't worry, he could just wait a certain amount of years before then pooping out another hyper-powerful Sith Lord to do his job for him. It appears Snoke was turned into a pickle. Most confusing shit I have ever seen. Bet all you fan theorists look real dumb now. Snoke never mattered. Such a waste of a character. Comedy gold. Palpy tells Kylo that he's been putting the voices of Darth Vader and Snoke into his head his entire life, which eventually tipped him over to the dark side. So that means Kylo realizes his entire life has been a lie and that he's a terrible person, right? Well, unfortunately, Kylo's as much of a person as he is a functioning adult, so the lights upstairs are clearly turned off as of now. No interesting character arcs in sight here. Another thing you'll notice about this movie is that while the visuals overall are absolutely stunning, in fact, I consider the visuals to be the best part about the film, the amount of blue that's in the film can get kind of annoying. Like, blue is a very pretty color, but it takes up like 60% of the lighting in most of the scenes in this movie. And then there are things like Kylo's Star Destroyer being completely filled with blue. This may seem like a rather small thing to criticize, but it's kind of hard to praise the visuals when it looks like a Smurf has ejaculated all over the movie. Palpatine offers Kylo an entire fleet of thousands of Star Destroyers if he finds Rey and kills her. But these aren't just ordinary Star Destroyers, guys. These ones have Death Star cannons. Why? Because fuck you. Palpatine summons these Star Destroyers and pulls them out of the ground. What the fuck? A few things here. Is Palpatine seriously so ridiculously strong that he can pull thousands of Star Destroyers out from the ground of a planet using the Force? I get the dude is strong, but goddamn, don't do steroids, children. And secondly, Sheev, can you explain to me why you thought it was a good idea to build thousands of Star Destroyers and then throw them out of the fucking ground? What was the reason for this? Why not just put them on the ground for takeoff? Don't just lift them out from the floor, you fucking cripple. Also, later on in the film, there are people in the Star Destroyers. They're underground. Are you okay, film? None of this makes any sense. How are there people on these Star Destroyers? Why did you plow them through the fucking ground as if that wouldn't cause damage to any of them or your own hideout? Just, okay, my brain is fried. Scene over. Let's move on. We jump to Finn and Poe in the ice comet that we saw in the trailer. They're collecting intel that has been gathered by a spy in the First Order? Okay. I wonder who that could be. Is it Hux? No, that wouldn't make any sense at all for his character.
I'm the spy.
Fuck you. Well, we aren't at that fiasco yet, so let's see what we've got here instead. Given what happens in the scene after this, we can conclude that all this message really says is that Palpatine is alive, he has thousands of ships, you're gonna get fucking murdered. Is there a reason why this couldn't have been said to them as opposed to transferring the intel to R2-D2? Well, before your brain can register what's happening, because this movie's pacing moves about as quickly as America's coronavirus cases, they are ambushed by the First Order, who quickly give chase. Then the Falcon hyperspaces through the ice?
Some holdo maneuvers. Do some real damage.
Come on, that move is one in a million.
What the fuck is happening? Oh, and apparently TIE fighters can go into hyperspace and also track through hyperspace now. How inconvenient. But worry not, because Jujar is about to pull out his trap card and rape hyperspace like Ryan did in the previous movie.
What are you doing?
Light speed skipping? Oh, you mean doing that? That thing that was mentioned in the original trilogy is the main thing you should never do when going into hyperspace. You flatulence-based creature.
Traveling through hyperspace ain't like dusting crops, boy. Without precise calculations, we'd fly right through a star or bounce too close to a supernova and then it'd end your trip real quick, wouldn't it?
Light speed skipping!
You're a fucking idiot!
But just like everything in this trilogy doesn't make a lick of sense, it for some reason works. Wow, look at all these pretty visuals. I sure love competent filmmaking. Wait, was I thinking just now? Ah, whatever, it's a fucking Star Wars. Gotta love how they lose the TIE fighters because they can't seem to react to the massive monster right in front of them.
You dumb motherfuckers!
We then cut to Rey in the middle of her training. Which she apparently needs. But hey, anything to one-up Ryan, her bank jar? Also, this isn't really a major flaw, it's just really funny, but a tree accidentally falls on BB-8 while Rey is having one of her episodes and she tries to lift the tree off of her hands. What the hell have you been training for, exactly? Rey is then compelled by the plot to read a book on Wayfinders, because the plot is all she has to follow as a character at this point, before Poe finally shows up with a line that perfectly represents the Star Wars franchise.
Go fire!
Another thing you'll also notice is that these characters haven't been defined whatsoever despite it being the final movie in their own fucking trilogy. They're the protagonists. Barjo must have realized this because apparently these characters now have actual chemistry between them. Personally, I would have liked it a lot more if these characters had something that made them characters before this scene. Like an arc. Or a personality. But then we're immediately thrusted into the next scene.
Somehow Palpatine returned.
Good God, there were two writers for this movie. There was also a director, but it's easy to forget that sometimes when everyone's reaction to Wizard Hitler coming back from the dead is of mild displeasement. Here's how it really should have played out.
Somehow
Hitler turned.
Hitler.
Well, unfortunately, as hilarious as that would be, we're stuck with a group full of idiots being commanded by a script that Kiss used to wipe his teary ass with.
If we want to stop him, we must find him. Must find Accel.
Then some people begin to add some insightful meta-commentary on the movie's awful script as they wonder how Palpatine could possibly be back. Then, a random hobbit chimes in and says that it could be...
dark science. Cloning. Secrets only the Sith knew.
Ha ha ha! Fuck you, dialogue! Thankfully, because Rey randomly decided to start reading right before this scene, because she's Jesus, she knows that if they find a wayfinder, they can make it to Accel. So they all jump on board the Falcon. Whoops! Except for Rose, because this movie is an apology for The Last Jedi, guys. Now, there's apologizing for your previous mistakes, and then there's being desperate. Yes, Rose was a shitty character. Could she have come along to become a better character instead of acting as Rian Johnson's political mouthpiece? Absolutely. Could you have left her out of the film entirely? Absolutely. Should you choose the second option to have an entire scene dedicated to shooting her down just to try and please people who didn't like her? You might as well have killed her, to be honest. Next, we see that Kylo is repairing its helm- wow! Literally repairing the damage that Rian did with The Last Jedi. Way to go, guys. I know everyone's made this joke at this point, but I love how when the Supremacy exploded, Kylo was so desperate to get his helmet back that he had to walk back into the elevator and pick up all of the pieces. It was one of the many times I laughed at something completely unintentional in this movie. And God, there was a lot of unintentional comedy. Like this scene where Kylo flipped a guy up to the ceiling just for questioning what Palpy would want in return.
What is he asking for in return? Does that-
And before that happens, there's a scene where Kylo walks down a corridor of the Knights of Ren, who were teased in The Force Awakens, and The Last Jedi forgot about them, so, oh, that's where they're there, gotcha.
Knights of Ren, go.
There were two fucking writers for this movie. Oh, and there's also a general called Pride. Despite his name, his character does not relate to the LGBT community, although he does love to suck Palpatine's dick. He is a character that has been summoned into existence and has apparently existed way before the First Order and was a member of the Empire. This is the movie's way of making it look like this character is important, despite him not existing in any of the films where the Empire is present. He only really exists because Jar Banks was upset that Rian turned his ginger Nazi child into a spineless stress ball and needed to make the exact same character again, even having a scene where Pride literally kills the character who filled his position before him, now that he's basically useless. Something tells me these two movies don't really get along, I don't know what it is. We then cut back to our group of retards and see C-3PO on a new desert planet. A new one? Right, okay. One desert planet is pretty cool, a second one? Yeah, okay, fine. A third one, and the second desert planet in a trilogy? That just seems to me like the writers are running out of ideas, which in all honesty should be the tagline for this entire trilogy. Now you might think I'm going rather quickly, well that's not exactly my fault, because The Rise of Skywalker has to have the worst pacing out of any movie in the saga. It just keeps going and going and going and going and never stops to explain anything or have a scene with some emotional depth. It just has stuff happen on screen, distracts you with pretty lights, and just goes on and on and on and on. Jujar Bankrums wrote the script. That's a funny way of spelling Lightning fucking McQueen. Ka-chow. Speaking of fiery car crashes, apparently this festival that's going on only occurs every 42 years, an obvious reference to A New Hope being released. However, this is pretty outrageous in terms of the story because this exact festival just so happened to be taking place at the exact same fucking time as the adventure began. This very specific time for festival to happen occurs at the same time that Palpatine announces that the galaxy has 16 hours before its forfeit. Oh, and yes, 16 hours. This entire film takes place over the course of 16 hours. How in the name of quantum physics and basic understanding of time does this entire adventure take place over 16 hours? Why do you write like this, you absolute wank puffin? Anyway, because this festival is miraculously happening right now, it's going to make it a lot harder for them to search. Thanks, Jar Ju. Poe tells everyone that the First Order is always on patrol in these parts of the galaxy. This is the only explanation as to why this bastard of a scene happens in a second and does not excuse the fact that the First Order patrolling a random desert planet during a festival is completely silly, but it needs to be stakes, so fuck it, they're just here now. A weird alien child comes up to Rey and gives her a necklace, so Do they need to be reminded that the galaxy is about to get fucked in 16 hours? You should be going as fast as possible. What are these people doing? All of a sudden, Kylo contacts Rey and explains that Palpatine wants her dead, but that he has other plans. He is going to turn her to the dark side. Rey counters by saying that Kylo is still haunted by what he did to Han and that he's closer to the light side. I chime in and say,
"Done with it.
Yes, get over it.
I'm enjoying this scene.
Get on with it!"
Then Kylo goes up to Rey and takes the necklace off of her and it gets sent all the way over the galaxy to him. Holy shit. You people have no clue what you're doing. I've seen plenty of people try to dismiss Disney taking creative liberties with the Force with the fact that it's magic and apparently never had any rules to begin with. I wonder if there was an entire movie establishing what the Force was and what it was capable of doing, as well as establishing rules for it. Oh, I know, literally the second movie! And okay, I'm fine with Disney establishing new Force powers. For example, I don't mind Force torture being a thing. In fact, that seems like something anyone can do with the Force. I also don't mind a mere concept of Rey having Skype calls with Kylo, so long as they are simply calls, as in projections of their physical selves. If Kylo can simply take a necklace off of Rey while in the middle of a Force call, and that opens up a massive can of worms that tells me this power was not really thought of that well, more like it was thought of on the fly while having absolutely no idea what the possible implications of it could be. What if Rey did it but took away his lightsaber? What if Kylo did it but took her lightsaber? What if Kylo did it to Rey or one of her friends? And conversely, what if Rey could pull Kylo through? It is an absolutely ridiculous and stupid power. It makes absolutely no sense. It just shows that the writers can do whatever they think they can with the Force in terms of the plot, because it's just simply magic to them. At least with Force torture and catching lasers in midair, it makes sense how it works. With the Force now being able to do literally anything in service of the plot, it takes the story from the movie and rips it in half, while at the same time making it a fact that this power existed before the sequels even happened, which puts a massive hole in every single piece of Star Wars media that existed before this, and is one of the many parts of the film that manages to pull it off. Anyway, now that Kylo has Rey's necklace, she begins to panic because this apparently means Kylo knows where she is now. Kylo takes the necklace to get it scanned, which tells him that the necklace is from the planet that Rey, C-3PO, and the other extremely important characters are. Even though that shouldn't give him any info, because these people could exist in other places in the galaxy. Hell, I'm pretty sure there are locals here who have gone into space and to other planets. So Kylo has no actual lead on this, but I'm on a tight amount of time, so fuck it, he's just gonna go there now. Now this next string of scenes is where I'm gonna have to explain it as carefully as I can, because the film begins to lose its shit. Rey and her friends are running away at the thought of being captured by the First Order, and suddenly run into a random fucking stormtrooper who is just out here in the middle of the festival on his own. And then I shit you not, about 2 seconds after he is shown on screen, he is shot in the fucking eye with an arrow by a masked stranger, who then takes them to safety and reveals himself to be Lando fucking Calrissian. That was just one of the numerous mind-bending scenes that are stringed together, and it's not even the worst one. You will actually end up snapping your neck if you attempted to keep out of this movie's dreadful pacing. Holy shit, the stormtrooper's just out here chilling on his own, and before you can even register the fact that a stormtrooper noticed them, it just cuts to an arrow being shot in his fucking eye by a character who has absolutely no reason to be there at this specific time. Jesus Christ. That's also not taking into account how this movie is edited by a random fucking baboon with Parkinson's, and so the editing quickly snaps every few nanoseconds when it comes to scenes like this. Okay, apparently Lando was here years ago with Luke looking for a knife that belonged to Coochie, whatever the fuck his name is.
Coochie.
And Leia sent him a transmission telling him that they were arriving here soon. But it doesn't at all explain why the hell he's here right now, especially given the fact that the only reason he was needed here was upwards of 20 years ago, you dumbass movie. We're also told that Coochie's ship has been parked on the mountain for decades, and hasn't been stolen, stripped, or touched at all. It's just been visibly up on top of a mountain for ages and no one has given a fuck. How awfully convenient. Also, I find it funny that Leia called up Lando about these guys being on the planet. It didn't tell Rey or Thing 1 and 2 anything about him being there, despite him having information that they absolutely need. It's almost like Jar Jar and Geriatric thought they would get a massive theater reaction if they kept Lando's identity completely secret and never had the characters say where he was. I mean, once the reveal hype is over, the thought of many questions about Lando actually being here does pop into mind, but fuck you. Here's some action. No time for questions. That should also be the tagline for this movie, but I digress. Then Finn asks Poe how he knows lightsabers had a hot wire, a speeder, setting up one of the most pointless backstories for a character I've ever seen put to film. It also doesn't make any sense because he's a resistance pilot and one of the best resistance pilots. This seems like something he should know, you living fart. It's almost like the characters are tools and don't react like normal people would. In my Disney Star Wars movie, heavens no. We get an action scene that completely blows on every level, but I'd like to just point out a few things here. Why would you need to lift up your speeder just to propel someone who has a jetpack that allows them to fly in the air anyway? And why would you lift up your speeder anyway when it leaves you open to crashing into shit and seems incredibly dangerous on its own? Are you guys trying to lose? Okay, to be honest, trying to explain humor to the same people who thought Poe calling Hux to make a Your Mother joke was tonally consistent with Star Wars is probably a waste of my time.
Tell him Leia has an urgent message for him about his mother.
Finn also manages to throw a hook that gets caught in the treads and allows for a trooper to get completely decimated, despite the fact that these things have shields on them. Top tier writing. Also, why the fuck are you using treaded speeders? They have hover speeders and you don't for some reason. Again, are you trying to lose, you fucking bell sniff? But then all of a sudden, a random trooper has a shocking revelation. That sends everyone onto some quicksand. The trooper dies and all of a sudden everyone just starts sinking despite being completely fine a second ago. Movie magic. Finn tries to tell Rey something before they sink but gets cut off. This is then never brought up again for the remainder of the film. Now, if you were like me, given what very little we know about Finn, we could assume that Finn was trying to say he loved her. But apparently, because you no longer have to explain things in the film to make it cohesive, he was attempting to tell her that he was force sensitive. Wow, that's definitely something that mattered so much to the point of saying it at your death. For fuck's sake. The mystery gang fall underneath the sand, and apparently this was exactly what they needed to do to find what they needed. Don't think about it, it gets so much worse. They find Coochie's Sith Dagger, which apparently has the location of the second Wayfinder inscribed in it in Sith. Thankfully, C-3PO can read it. But unfortunately, he does not have the N-word passed, and thus cannot say the hard R. Imagine being such an autistic programmer that you give C-3PO the ability to read Sith, but not to say it out loud. Are you actually for real? Why would you design a robot with the ability to read a language, but not translate it out loud? In fact, why would you ever inscribe a Wayfinder location on a weapon? Rey then holds the knife and says,
"Horrible things have happened."
She says this while holding a lightsaber that has slaughtered a room full of children. But before you can register the insane stupidity being put on display in this one scene, a massive worm thing appears and kills Rey. No, what happens instead is that Rey notices this thing is injured and, I shit you not, begins to heal it using the Force. And once it's fully healed, it goes away and reveals a way out like a fucking video game. What the- Why do you write like this? This one force power somehow managed to ruin every emotional scene involving death and everything that came before this movie. This completely overpowered goblin who thought the force was a myth only a year ago was somehow able to use a power capable of healing severe wounds and bringing people back to life. When apparently Obi-Wan couldn't do the same for Qui-Gon, Anakin couldn't do the same for his mother, Obi-Wan couldn't do the same for Satine, Luke couldn't do the same for Vader. I think you get my point, this franchise is fucked. If this was always a thing, then did Anakin just turn to the dark side to save Padme because he is a massive whiny bitch? You be the judge on that one. The gang heads for Coochie's ship, which despite being left alone for decades, is still flyable and completely unlocked. Try not to think about it, because the next scene might just be one of the single worst scenes in all of Star Wars. Please try and stay with me, because this is completely fucked. Rey's spidey senses start tingling, and she wanders off into the desert to find Kylo. Why she's looking to directly face Kylo, when only a few minutes ago she was scared at the thought of being found and captured by him, is to anyone's guess. While she wanders off, no one tries to shout for her to come back whatsoever, and eventually send Chewie down with the dagger to fetch her, but he is caught by the Knights of Ren who are just chilling out. And for some reason, no one notices this, for God's sake. Then Kylo shows up and tries to run Rey over with his TIE fighter, despite explicitly stating that he wants to turn Rey to the dark side and not do what Palpatine wants him to do, you emotional wankcloth. Rey then destroys a part of his ship, and then he rolls at inhumanly high speed and fucking explodes, and I'm sorry, but I could not contain my laughter, especially after he's revealed to be completely fine. Movie magic. After this, we get what might be a visual representation of shit-flavored fudge mixed with gasoline. I am not kidding, it is that bad. Rey tries to pull down Kylo's ship, but then Kylo counters it, and then against all the odds in the known universe, Rey... Rey...
Voy a la playa, voy a subir la marea.
¡Tú! ¡Había subido la mano y con triple paella! ¡Tú! ¡Y la encontré! Porque te estaba la paellera agarrada. Entremetí entre las piedras de Chipiona, de Faro. Y cuando entro en el restaurante, me ve el cocinero con una paellera y adentro la vende paellera.
Rey, without any prior experience of using the dark side, accidentally uses one of the most advanced dark side abilities in a fit of rage that ends up incinerating Chewbacca. For a scene that is supposed to be shocking and emotional, the only thing it made me do was laugh uncontrollably for about 5 minutes before making me question what the hell I just witnessed. The Knights of Ren are parked right next to them, yet they do fuck all to actually stop them. They only manage to capture Chewbacca, and even then, how did no one even notice this? In fact, how did they even get here in the first place without anyone noticing? Spaceships aren't exactly equipped for stealth, guys. And of all people you decide to send down, you send down the one person who has the dagger. I mean, at the same time, they no longer need the dagger now that C-3PO knows what it says. I'll discuss this dagger soon enough, because holy hell does it fuck up a lot.